To worship our great God. Just a few announcements this morning as we get started. First of all, it's fun to see a number of our college students returning back to the area and here with us even this morning, and more will come in this coming week. And our team that went to Poland is back. It's good to have them back as well. They got back early this week. As the school year gets close to starting, sadly, we'll be losing a couple of our college students as well. I know at least for AJ and BJ, this is their last Sunday with us before they head back. Isn't that right, guys? So make sure to say hello to them, or I guess goodbye is a little more appropriate in this case. But they have been such a blessing this summer, haven't they? It's been a joy to have them here, and we'll miss them during the school year, so touch base with them today. A couple of other things going on today. If those that are planning to attend men's retreat could meet up at the front of the auditorium near the orchestra area here after the morning service just to make plans for travel. Men's retreat is coming up this weekend, Friday and Saturday, and we're looking forward to that. As well as if the decor team could meet up on this side of the auditorium after the morning service, we'll have a brief meeting as well. A few other things coming up. I mentioned men's retreat already. Let's see here. Oh, this Saturday, we have a bridal shower for Chelsea Thompson. So, ladies, I hope you'll join us for that Saturday here at the church at 10 o'clock a.m. What else am I missing? Oh, next Sunday, there's a number of special things going on. First of all, we'll begin choir rehearsals that Sunday afternoon, and Aaron Lansdowne will come in a moment and share a little bit more about that, as well as the start of Awana. But in 2 weeks, we'll be starting our fall Sunday school quarter. Hard to believe that fall is upon us, isn't it? Wow. Give your sigh of goodbye to summer. We still have a couple weeks left, I guess. But September 2nd, we'll be starting our new Sunday school classes, and that's what that insert in your bulletins is about. So again, a bit confusing maybe, but it doesn't start next week. This will start in 2 weeks, September 2nd, and that's up there at the top. We'll have a class on 1 Corinthians, kind of walking through the book of 1 Corinthians. That'll be taught by Del Moeller, and that'll be on the south side of the Fellowship Hall. We'll have a class, this will be in our Christian Living track, on strengthening marriages. We're calling it Tightening the Knot. It's based on actually a premarital counseling book called Tying the Knot. And so we'll be kind of, it gives a great foundation for marriage. And so we'll be working through this book, but applying it to those who are already married. And so we're calling it Tightening the Knot. So that's kind of how that one will work. I'll be teaching that one as well as a number of other speakers, as you see listed there. And that'll be on the north side of the Fellowship Hall. The College and Career class will be doing one on managing your money. And then the ladies' class will be doing Serving in the Power of the Holy Spirit, working through the book of Acts. So some exciting courses coming up next quarter. I hope you'll plan. If you haven't been coming to Sunday school, I hope you'll plan to start attending this coming quarter, September 2nd. One thing that we're going to start doing with our class topics is try to have a more intentional scope and sequence is what we call it. And so we'll always try to have a Bible class that you can attend, working through scripture, and then we'll rotate between a doctrine class and a Christian living class, and so those will kind of be our two tracks. We'll try to always have classes on those two ideas, a Bible class, and then either Christian living or doctrine, and of course this quarter it's Bible and Christian living, and we'll hope you'll join us for those classes coming up in 2 weeks. Okay, I'm going to have Aaron Lansdowne come and share a little bit about both Awana and choir, which will be starting up for the fall here soon.
Good morning. Awana is quickly coming upon us, with our first day being August 29th is when we'll open up Awana. With that being said, we need to do some training. And so we are having mandatory training for everybody that is wanting to help on the... See, it'd be this coming Wednesday at 7 o'clock, and we urge everybody again that is helping out to come to that training. There's a sign up in the back if you have not signed up to help out yet. And don't worry if you miss the sign up, you can still come to the training, you can still plan on helping out, but there's just some things we need to cover regarding scoring and a couple of other things. So again, that's a mandatory meeting this Wednesday at 7 o'clock. And church families, we are urging you, if you have kids that are going to be in Awana, we urge you to register. We are going to be pre-register. We're going to open up registering prior to the meeting on Wednesday and after the meeting on Wednesday night. And then again, next Sunday after the morning service, we'll have pre-registration open. That way, on opening night of Awana, we are able to focus on the community families and getting them registered as quickly as possible. So if you could plan on that, pre-register your kids, we'd appreciate that. Choir is starting up next week. Choir rehearsals are starting up next week. There is a sign up in the back. Don't worry again if you miss that. We are encouraging everybody to come and everybody that's interested in choir to come and join in the rehearsal. The sign up is more for my sake, just so I can have an idea of who's coming, what voice parts I'm going to have represented and whatnot. So if you miss that sign up, don't worry about it. It's not a huge deal. It's just for my sake. With that said, let's go ahead and transition to our song service by turning your attention to the screen above me or behind me, and it will sing together, "There is an Everlasting Kindness." And you can go ahead and stand as we sing.
There is an everlasting kindness you lavished on us when the radiance of heaven came to rescue the lost. You called the sheep without a shepherd to leave their distress. For your streams of forgiveness and the shade we
you take out your blue hymnals, you can turn with me to hymn number 89. All the Way My Savior Leads Me, hymn number 89, your blue hymnals. We'll remain standing as we sing. Wonderful singing this morning. You may be seated.
Let's continue in worship this morning by a time of prayer, if you'll pray with me. Father, we thank you for being a God who cares for our needs. We've sung about it already this morning. You sent your Son with that purpose in mind, meeting our needs, caring for our needs as people who are lost, enemies of you because of our sin. You sent one who would be our mediator, giving his life so that we might have peace with you, so that he might bring us to you. As we come to your word this morning, we look forward to seeing our Savior, the shepherd, the one that you have sent not only to be the shepherd of your people Israel, but also acts as our shepherd. And we thank you for that. We thank you that we can trust your providing hand through your Son, Jesus Christ, that you give us guidance through his love and care in our lives, that you provide for all of our needs, that we can look to you and trust you. We thank you for our shepherd, Jesus. Help us as we come to your word to prepare our hearts, even as we worship this morning, to be rid of those things that have brought a wedge between us and you. We might come to you with pure hearts, confessing our sin and forsaking these things, coming before your throne, ready to worship you, to see you more clearly from your word, and to live lives that are different as we understand that Jesus is our shepherd. We pray that your Spirit would work in a mighty way this morning to help our hearts not only to understand the truth, but to apply it to our lives, to live differently. As we need, Father, convict us of sin and help us to see how our Savior is all that we need for this life, our shepherd. We thank you. There are many here this morning, and even those that can't be with us, who are hurting, who need your help, who need to see and know that you are their shepherd through Jesus. And so we ask for you to work, and we pray in his precious name. Amen.
Next hymn that we'll be singing is hymn number 460 in our blue hymnals, He Leadeth Me. We're going to be singing the first, second, and fourth stanza. And when we get to the fourth stanza, we'll sing through the the verse, and then when we get to the chorus, we'll ask that the instrumentation drop out, and we'll sing that fourth chorus a cappella. They'll stand as we sing together hymn number 460 in our blue hymnals, He Leadeth Me. You may be seated. At this time, we'll prepare to take the morning offering. We'll ask the ushers to come forward. If you are a visitor this morning, this is an opportunity for our members and full-time, our regular attenders to give back to the church and to use our funds to further the ministry of our church and to spread the gospel. So feel free to just pass this plate on by if you're a visitor this morning. Let's go ahead and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to meet together as a congregation, to lift our voices in unison to you. And Lord, I pray that you are honored and glorified in that. Lord, I want to pray as we give, as we worship in our giving, that you would use these funds to further your gospel and that you'd be honored and glorified in our giving. And I want to pray for your blessing over this offering. I pray these things in your name. Amen.
Thank you.
This morning's music selection has been focused on Christ as our shepherd and how we trust him to lead us through various trials and just life in general. And in the top of your bulletin this morning, let's read this verse out of Mark 6:34. It says, "And Jesus, when he came out, saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion for them, because they were like sheep, not having a shepherd. So he began to teach them many things." This next hymn is a hymn that I found as I was looking through different things. It's a new hymn to us. It's called "My Shepherd Will Supply My Need." I'll ask that Caitlin plays through it, but just to draw your attention a little bit to the elements of Psalm 23 that are found throughout here, but then just keeping the verse that I just read in mind as well as we read the text, as we sing the text, and I just want to draw your attention to the words of the song as well. So I'll ask that she play through it once so that we can hear the melody, and we'll just follow along with the slides for now, and then we'll just do the first stanza there, and then we'll come back and sing it together as a congregation. Join me in standing as we sing, "My Shepherd Will Supply My Need."
My Shepherd. I
You may be seated. I did forget to dismiss the children for Children's Church, so if there's any of you left in here, I saw some of them getting out of here already, you may be dismissed. And at this time, Caitlin comes to minister to us in special music.
Thank you, Caitlin. Lord, I need you. Important words. I wonder if they reflect the sentiments of your heart this morning. Do you sense your need for Jesus today? You can answer that question two ways, yes or no. Either you're here and you do sense your need for Jesus today, or maybe you're here and you're thinking, oh, I'm not so sure. Not so sure I need Jesus, or I need to depend on him. This morning's passage, we look at Jesus as a shepherd. And it's hard to think about a shepherd very long before thinking about sheep. Have you ever done any research on sheep or spent any time around sheep? The more I learn about sheep, the more I wonder whether God created them purely to be an example or a metaphor to us of our need for God. Sheep are needy animals. I was told by a friend who grew up near a sheep farm that it was actually possible for a sheep to fall over on its back, and if it rolled over too far, it would get stuck that way and would not be able to right itself again And the gas within the sheep's body would end up killing the sheep because it could not right itself. And I don't know how that all works, but apparently that's possible and happens frequently if you as a shepherd are not looking out for your tipped over sheep. Here in Iowa, we joke about cow tipping. Well, sheep tipping is much more serious, apparently. So, sheep are needy creatures. They are. They need to be shown where to eat, and they need to be shown how to get there, and then they need to be guided back to the pen. And the list could go on and on and on as you think about sheep. And so then we begin to think, well, why is Jesus called a shepherd? Well, it's a metaphor, isn't it, for the way he cares for his own. So that then begs the question I began with. Do we really need him? We need this shepherd to guide us and to feed us and to help us when we get tipped over and so on and so forth. Yes, the answer is yes, we need him. And so if you're listening today and you answer that question no right now in your own life, I hope to persuade you that this morning you do need Jesus as your shepherd. If you answer that question yes, then I hope to encourage you with the ways that Jesus is your shepherd. And the ways that you can follow him and lean on him and trust him in the stuff of life. We encounter the disciples in Mark chapter 6, beginning in verse 30. And here in this verse, it's actually the conclusion to a part of a story we've already studied together 2 weeks ago when Jesus sent the disciples out to do ministry. And the reality is, I think the disciples, in their own minds, maybe kind of wondering that same question, do we really need Jesus? Maybe not that they would say that outwardly or even think that clearly in their heads, but they've just had this successful ministry. And you'll see, even in their responses to Jesus, some hints at the fact that maybe they're becoming a little self-dependent here. They're a little self-strong. Yeah, well, we were able to heal people. Yes, in Jesus' strength, but we ministered, and boy, it was really successful. And they come back to Jesus, and they report on their ministry. And notice the first things that happen in Mark chapter 6, verse 30 and following. The apostles gathered to Jesus and told him all the things, both what they had done and what they had taught. And he said to them, "Come aside by yourselves to a deserted place and rest a while." For there were many coming and going, and they did not even have time to eat. So they departed to a deserted place in the boat by themselves. So Jesus begins by really kind of shepherding them here and saying, "Well, you need some rest after this ministry. Let's step away for a bit and get some rest." Well, as we work through the story, you'll see it doesn't quite go as planned, and this ends up leading into a miracle we know well, the feeding of the 5,000. It's actually one of the only miracles mentioned in all four Gospels. The only other one is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So this is a miracle we're familiar with, but it's important that we understand the context and what is going on here. Look at verse 34, for instance. "And Jesus, when he came out, saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion for them because they were sheep not having a shepherd. So he began to teach them many things." We'll get to this verse as we study down through this story, but I want to look at that verse first because it helps us to understand the context. This is all a part of Jesus revealing his identity. You remember these questions we've been asking as we work through the Gospel of Mark. Who is Jesus and what does it mean to follow him? Here, Jesus begins to reveal himself as the prophesied Messiah, specifically the shepherd of Israel. The shepherd of Israel. What does that mean? The shepherd of these scattered, lost people. Okay, let's take a little adventure here, a little detour to the book of Ezekiel. Difficult one to find. We won't do a sword drill or anything. It's in the Old Testament, one of the prophets. The book of Ezekiel, and we'll look specifically at chapter 34. Here's one of a number of prophecies that look forward to this coming shepherd. Ezekiel chapter 34, we'll look first at verses 4 and 5, and then we'll look at a couple more verses, and I'll tell you which ones when we get there. Ezekiel chapter 34, Notice first of all verses 4 and 5. This is a condemnation against the current shepherds of Israel who are not doing their job well. These would have been the leaders, the priests, the leaders of Israel at this time were not doing their job. So verse 4, the weak you have not strengthened, nor have you healed those who were sick, nor bound up the broken, nor brought back what was driven away, nor sought what was lost, but with force and cruelty you have ruled them. So they were scattered because there was no shepherd. And they became food for all the beasts of the field when they were scattered. So you see this metaphor there about the people of Israel? It continues on in verses 11 through 15. Notice the descriptions here. For thus says the Lord God, indeed, I myself will search out my sheep and seek them out as a shepherd seeks out his flock on the day he is among his scattered sheep. So will I seek out my sheep and deliver them from all the places where they were scattered on a cloudy and dark day. And as we go on, it talks about him gathering his sheep back together. So these are some prophecies about something that God will do in the future through this one, this shepherd. Now notice verses 22 and 23. Ezekiel chapter 34. Therefore I will save my flock, and they shall no longer be a prey. And I will judge between sheep and sheep. I will establish one shepherd over them, and he shall feed them, my servant David. He shall feed them and be their shepherd. Now this comes after the time of David. So this prophecy is actually about a coming one who would be of the line of David, who would be the shepherd of the people Israel. Can you guess who this prophecy is talking about? It's talking about Jesus. And so here Jesus sees these people, these Jewish people, and as the Messiah, as the prophesied shepherd of the people of Israel, he sees them without one to teach them and guide them, and he sees them as sheep without a shepherd, and it hints at his coming day when he will return and gather Israel together and be their shepherd. We look forward to that time in the millennial kingdom. We do. So Jesus is hinting at his identity as the shepherd of Israel. Now, go back to the Gospel of Mark, and I want you to keep that shepherd persona in mind. Now, this prophecy that we looked at in Ezekiel and this phrasing here has to do with Israel and their need of a shepherd to guide them. But as we read through the New Testament, we also understand that God uses that metaphor of a shepherd time and time again. And we know that he as well is our shepherd. In fact, if you look at 1 Peter chapter 2, you don't have to turn there. I hate to get you jumping too many places this morning, but 1 Peter chapter 2 refers to Jesus this way in our context. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 24 and 25. Who himself, Jesus, bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sins, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. For you were like sheep going astray, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. He's talking to people who've trusted in Christ, all believers, not just Jews now in this context, but all believers. We see Jesus as our shepherd, the one who is the overseer of our souls. And so we experience that shepherding of our Jesus. Well, just look with me at this passage as we consider Jesus as the shepherd, the one who cares for our needs. How does he shepherd his people? First of all, he leads us to rest. He leads us to rest. So follow him. We saw this already with his disciples. They return from their ministry experience and they begin to tell him all that they've done. And the first thing he says is, well, let's get away from the crowds so that we can rest. And there's a couple things they're getting away from. First, they're getting away from the people. So they go to a deserted place. They also are getting away from the busyness. It says they didn't even have time to eat because of the busyness. So they depart from the people and from the busyness. They're with Jesus. It's just the 12 of them now. And likely Jesus is going to instruct them a little bit and interact with them about their journey. And it says they departed to a deserted place in the boat by themselves. So he helps them to get away. Now, this story, this account, is mentioned in all four Gospels. And so we learn a little bit from the other Gospels as well about the specifics of this scenario. We're told in the other Gospels that they're actually heading to an area near a city called Bethsaida, which would have been on the north-northeast portion of the Sea of Galilee. And so really, the disciples are heading from the north-northwest, or if I reverse it for you here, the north-northwest, and they're heading kind of just a little loop into the lake and back up to the coast again on the north-northeast portion of the sea. So by land, they're actually not going that far. They're using the boat to kind of create some distance, and then they'll land again near Bethsaida. Now, that'll come up again in our story, and you'll understand why that's important. But it's a short journey in the boat, a few hours maybe less, and then they're planning to land at sea. But the point is that Jesus leads them to rest. Sometimes Jesus, I think, leads us to rest, and it's important that we follow him. Now, this is an interesting point. It's not the main point of the passage, but I think it is a lesson for us to learn as we understand how Jesus, our shepherd, cares for our needs. Sometimes he leads us to rest. I believe that's true. Sometimes we are like little kids who fight naps. You ever done any babysitting and tried to get a child to go down for a nap? I went through a stage where I hated naps, and then, of course, you know, around college age or maybe a little older, it's like, when can I get a nap? I mean, I would long for a nap. We kind of transition that, and then we get to a stage of life where we're too busy for naps anymore, or if we take a nap in the afternoon, we know we won't sleep at night, right? And so we don't want to throw off our sleeping pattern. When I talk about Jesus leading to us to a place of rest, I don't mean just a place of sleep. As he brought the disciples away, the point was not necessarily sleep in this case. The point was to get away from the busyness, to be able to reflect on what had happened, to listen to him and have him teach them. I think it's important for us to take these times of rest. In fact, they are an acknowledgement of our dependence upon God. If we are ministering in our own strength, if we are ministering for our own glory, we're often hesitant to rest, because it's dependent on us. Well, if I step away, then how's it going to survive? Or who's going to be able to care for it? Or maybe they'll do it better than I would. Sometimes we're worried about our reputation. It can be a performance-based Christianity. To rest is to acknowledge our dependence upon him, to reflect on what he's teaching him, and then most importantly, to spend time with him. Can movies and video games provide rest? Well, maybe in a form. But I think the greatest kind of rest is to go to him, to spend time with him, to get into his word and to be taught by him and refreshed from him. He says in Matthew 11, 28, "Come to me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." So real rest, real refreshment comes from Jesus. And as our shepherd, he provides that for us. I think this is a challenge for many of us as Christians. We don't like to rest. We like to be busy, and we take it even as a point of pride that, oh, I'm doing so much for the Lord, but am I taking the rest that he's leading me to? Am I spending time with him to get that refreshment? It's important. Well, I don't want to belabor that, but that is one way that Jesus, as our shepherd, leads us. He leads us to rest. Notice how else our shepherd leads us as he works with the disciples here in verse 33. "But the multitude saw them departing, and many knew him, and ran there on foot from all the cities, and they arrived before them and came together to him." And Jesus, when he came out, saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion for them because they were like sheep not having a shepherd. So he began to teach them many things. So just picture this scene with me, okay? You have the tired disciples, and Jesus receives them back, and he begins to hear about what they've done, and says, okay, let's get into the boat, let's get away from the crowds, and we'll sail across a small portion of the lake, we'll land back on the shore, we'll have some time together. Well, the multitudes see Jesus with the disciples. This is likely a crowd that is on their way to Jerusalem for Passover. And so this is an added number of people than even maybe normally would have been in that area. And they see Jesus. This is actually Jesus' third tour through Galilee. He's been ministering there for a number of years now. And they recognize him. And they want to have some time with Jesus. So they see the boat taking out off onto the water. And they kind of press up on the shore. And I don't know who had the bright idea, but one of them pipes up and says, well, let's just follow along the shore. We can be at the shore wherever they land. And so they begin following along the shore, kind of watching the boat from the land and waiting for them to come to shore. Now, Jesus, of course, knows all this is happening. But as he sees the multitudes there waiting for them, it says that he's moved with compassion, feels pity for them. So there's a side lesson with rest, and it is that there will be times that we need some rest and intend to get some rest, and something else comes up, and God is sovereign even over those times, isn't he? And here Jesus, rather than being disappointed or frustrated with the crowds, he sees them and he's moved with compassion. Our shepherd cares for our needs. And what does he give them? When he's moved with compassion, it says that he begins to teach them. Begins to teach them. See, Jesus sees their greatest need as a multitude, wandering, looking for guidance, and he sees that they need to be taught. He shares with them truth about who he is, that he is the Messiah, the one they need to trust, that they would repent and turn from their sins and believe in him as the Messiah. So he begins to teach them. He teaches. I love the picture of our Jesus there as he is compassionate with these people and begins to teach them. We have a compassionate Savior. He is moved by our needs, and we need to understand that he is often first and foremost acting upon our spiritual needs. We tend to want our physical needs to be met first, but Jesus is often most concerned with our spiritual needs. Not that he won't provide for the physical, but he looks to the spiritual first. So as our shepherd, he meets our spiritual needs. So what do we need to do? We need to listen to him. He begins to teach these people. His point was to teach them that they would listen to him, that they would learn from him, and we too need to be taught by our shepherd in order to have our spiritual needs met. I remember counseling someone one time, and they came to me with this just great concern. They said, I don't feel spiritually fed. I don't feel God's presence in my life. I don't feel like he's there, and I don't feel like I'm having my spiritual needs met. That was the bottom line. I began to ask some questions and see what was going on, and it really came down to this. I asked, are you spending any time with him? Are you getting in his word? Are you learning from him? Are you hearing preaching on a regular basis? Are you personally on a day-to-day basis getting in the word? Do you have a relationship with him? And the answer to all those things was no. God's not going to be speaking into our lives if we are not seeking him in the word, spending time with him, listening to him, learning from his teachings as we study the scriptures, as we learn more about our God. Yes, Jesus meets our spiritual needs, but we need to listen. I love his compassion here. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15 confirms this truth to us, that we have a compassionate Savior who understands our needs. In chapter 4, verse 15, it says, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. You see, Jesus lived as a man and understood what it means to be human. He knows our needs, both physical and spiritual, and he provides for them. So we must listen. We must listen. The word also tells us that we've been given everything we need for life and godliness. Where? In the knowledge of God. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. All that we need, we find in him as we know him. We must listen to him. We must listen to his word. So go to him with your spiritual needs. Your soul needs to be reconciled to God. Only Jesus provides that. Your soul needs to be freed from guilt. Only Jesus provides that. Your soul needs forgiveness. Only Jesus provides that. Your soul needs rest and peace. Only Jesus provides that. You can fill that blank in with whatever you want. If your soul needs it, only
Jesus provides it. We need to go to him with our needs, trust him to provide. He's our shepherd. As we continue on in the passage, we find something else out about this shepherd, Jesus. Number three, he empowers all true ministry. And here we get into the miracle itself, and we begin to understand a little bit what might be going on in the disciples' minds in the background as we see that they're maybe not as dependent on Jesus as they ought to be. So Jesus is here teaching the crowds, and verse 35, the disciples bring up a problem. Notice what happens. When the day was now far spent, his disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is already late. Send them away that they may go into the surrounding country and villages and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat." But he answered and said to them, "You give them something to eat." And they said to him, "Shall we go and buy 200 denarii worth of bread and give them something to eat?" And we'll pause there before Jesus enters into this provision, this miracle. We know what happens next. But here's Jesus ministering to the people, and the disciples, instead of taking in the words of Jesus, begin to look at the circumstances. These ministry experts begin to realize that, oh, wait a second, it's getting late, and there's a lot of people here. And the nearest town's not for quite a ways away, and it's small enough that there's not going to be enough food for all these people to eat there, and they haven't brought lunches with them, and what are we going to do? And so our disciples, the ministry experts that they are, begin to bring this problem to Jesus, and they say, oh, the hour's late, and it's going to be dark, and there's not enough food to feed these people. What are we going to do? Jesus points out their self-dependency by his question. He says, "You give them something to eat." And the phrasing is actually emphatic. Another way to translate it would be, "You yourselves give them something to eat." Now, they know that's impossible. Jesus knows that's impossible. We'll understand a little bit more as we continue in the text. But what he's pointing out to the disciples here is that they need him in ministry. They're not sufficient in and of themselves to do these ministry tasks without him. They need him in ministry. They need to depend on him in ministry. Their best ministry idea is to send the people away, which sometimes we wonder, maybe ministry would be easier if we just sent the people away, right? But no, this is not what Jesus is all about here. No, this is not the solution that he wants to provide. They reach a dead end, and he wants them to know that they need him. They need him. They offer another solution. They say, well, maybe we should go somewhere and buy that much bread. Where in the world are we going to do that? The amount that they list, 200 denarii, would be maybe around $10,000 worth of bread. Whoa. You'd have to stop at a lot of grocery stores to buy that much bread. Where are we going to get that much bread? How are we going to feed these people? You see, this is an impossible task for them, and Jesus wants them to see that they need to depend on Jesus. Jesus empowers all true ministry, and we must depend on him. You and I, we can speak words of encouragement, but only Jesus can encourage a soul. We can share the gospel, but only Jesus can save a person. We can preach the word, but only Jesus can change the heart. We can gather and serve, but only Jesus can build his church. You understand, we must depend on Jesus for all true ministry. We must. And to go about it in our own strength is to miss the point entirely. He wants attention to be drawn to him and his great power, and that's about to be what we're going to see. As we come to verses 38 through 44, we get to the heart then of the miracle, and we see that Jesus meets all our needs. We must trust him. Notice what happens as we read verse 38 and following. Then he said to them, How many loaves do you have? Go and see. When they found out, they said, 5 and 2 fish. Then he commanded them to make all the groups sit down in groups on the green grass. And so they sat down in ranks, in hundreds and in fifties. And when he had taken the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven, blessed, and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples to set before them. And the 2 fish he divided among them all. So they all ate and were filled. And they took up 12 baskets full of fragments and of the fish. Now those who had eaten the loaves were about 5,000 men. Let's dive into this miracle here as we see our Jesus' incredible demonstration of power and provision for these people. The disciples have fallen short, but he decides to still use them, to help them be encouraged. Okay, you can still be a part of what I'm about to do here. So he says, go and see how much food you can find. We're told in one of the other Gospels that Andrew comes back having found a young boy who has his lunch with him, and it has 5 loaves and 2 fish. This, keep in mind, is a lunch for a young boy. So these 5 loaves are likely small little barley rolls, maybe even crackers that this boy would have eaten. And these 2 fish, we're not imagining your, you know, growing largest catch here. These 2 fish are small, salted, dried fish, probably more the size of sardines. Do you like sardines? I wonder how these tasted as they came from Jesus' hands on that day. But at any rate, that's what we're imagining here is some small rolls, maybe even crackers, and some small fish. And you have to imagine the disciples as they bring this to Jesus, and they're kind of wondering, okay, well, we found this, but, you know, what is this going to do? In fact, they ask that question in one of the other Gospels. What is this among so many? They don't yet understand. Jesus receives the food and he commands all the people to sit down. And in my opinion, this is another side miracle in this story, that this group of 5,000 men is what we're told, but likely there were at least double that as you include women and children. So we're talking 10,000 or more, some estimate near maybe 25,000 even. And as he commands this group to sit in ranks, or garden plots is actually the word that's used, so you can imagine kind of rows of 50s and 100, that actually happens. Kind of a side miracle, I think, as Jesus commands it to be done and this large group organizes themselves there on the green grass in probably March or April, that time that this takes place. And so there they are, and it's a picturesque scene as the people are out on the green field in organized groups, and there are these 5 crackers or small rolls and 2 fish there in front of Jesus, and everyone's kind of wondering what's going to happen next. We're told in the text that Jesus blesses the food, and then he begins to break it. That's a common phrasing, and it sounds like the blessing is coming upon the food, like some magic touch or something like this. This is not at all what happened. That's a phrase that was used frequently, and it really means that they're thanking the Lord for the food that has been given. So Jesus looks up to heaven and acknowledges that even this small meal has come from God. Yes, through the hands of a responsible mother who sent her son with 5 loaves and 2 fish and ended up feeding a multitude by God's power. So Jesus thanks the Lord for the food and begins to break these things. And as he hands it out to the disciples, it just continues to be present as he breaks it off and gives to them, and breaks it off and gives to them, and more food is handed out. And we're told about these baskets that appear at the end of the story. That's likely the very same baskets they used to hand it out. They're small wicker baskets that people in this time often carried with them. They could attach them to a belt or something else small enough to carry on their side in case they needed to move food around or something else. And so they scrounged up 12 of these baskets, and the disciples are using them to deliver the food, and then they come back to Jesus, and we don't know how long the process took, but he continues to break and continues to break as God performs this incredible miracle and multiplies the food on that day, and the people eat from the Creator's hands. What a day. Can you imagine being there? Maybe it did taste like sardines, but maybe this was the best fish they'd ever had. We don't know, but the food is dispersed and people eat. And what's amazing is that every single one of them there present on that day is filled. What's even more amazing is that the disciples pick up 12 wicker baskets full of food that is left over. We often breeze past that fact, and it's not something that we need to highlight too much, but I think it is interesting that there just so happens to be exactly 12 baskets full. I think maybe Jesus, the teacher, the shepherd, is hinting at something to his disciples here. Not only do I have the power to provide for all the needs of the people here that need to eat today to the full, but I can provide so exactly that I can teach my disciples a lesson and they can see the abundance of my provision for my people. That he is the one with the power to provide for those needs. And each of the disciples, maybe a little bit sheepishly, comes back to Jesus with their basket full. Whoa. He did that. Jesus, the shepherd, meets all of our needs. He has the power to do it. He doesn't just promise it, but he knows our needs perfectly, and he fills our needs to the fullest. And so we must trust him. We must trust him. We must recognize that as we look to Jesus to provide our needs, he is first and foremost at work with our spiritual, eternal needs, which is a realm we often don't look to first. This means that sometimes Jesus, yes, does allow hard things in our lives, difficult things in our lives, in order to grow us spiritually or even to increase our eternal riches. Yes, he does work that way. But he also has promised to provide for our physical needs too. And he is so trustworthy that in fact we can look to Jesus to understand what our needs are. If I have it, if he's provided it, if he's given me a means to get it, then I have what I need. If I can't get it or I don't have it, I so trust my Savior that I know I must not need it. You see, that's the kind of provision that our Savior gives. So precise, even down to the 12th basket full. We can trust him. We can trust him. He feeds the people to help them look past their physical hunger. One last passage we will look at in the Gospel of John, chapter 6, where this account is recorded for us in John's Gospel. John chapter 6, we're explained there, we have explained to us there kind of the purpose behind this miracle in verses 22 and following. Jesus is with the people there, and they see the boat, and his disciples are there in verse 22. And as you work down through verse 26, Jesus then begins to explain what the purpose of all this was. Jesus answered and said to them, "Most assuredly, I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him." See, Jesus points out that there are those who start to follow him now, and all they're after is another meal, another lunch, another breakfast. Wow, did you see that? He multiplied the food. And Jesus says, no, the whole point of this was that you would look past the physical provision and see me as the bread of life. See me as the one who can provide salvation, to look to everlasting life, not to bread for today, but to look to eternal things. See, this is what Jesus is teaching through these miracles, that he is the one who meets all of our needs, so we must trust him. We must look to him. We can ask this question as we face challenges in life: what can my shepherd accomplish here? This is beyond me. What can God do through this? How will he show his power? Maybe you're here today and you're not under the shepherd's care. You've never trusted in Jesus Christ. You've never received the bread of life, Jesus himself, the one who solves our eternal problem. Can I invite you today to receive Jesus as your shepherd and Savior? The scripture is clear that he came, and this first coming that we're reading about in the Gospel of Mark, this first coming was to seek and to save those who are lost, to give his life a ransom for many. He came to die for those who have sinned against God, which, as we learn from his word, is all of us. And so those of us who have sinned against God need this Jesus. We need his payment, his death on the cross in order to be saved. And the Bible is clear that by believing in his work, his death and resurrection, we receive a right relationship with God, peace with God. He becomes our shepherd. Would you receive him today? If he is your shepherd, then maybe as you look at the ways that he provides for us and you work through this passage, you realize that there is an area in your life where you need to begin to trust him more. Maybe he's leading you to take some rest, to draw near to him and to be refreshed. Maybe he's leading you to trust him for your spiritual needs. So listen to him. Maybe he's leading you to depend on him in ministry. You've been going in your own strength and need to look to him again. Maybe it is that you need to trust him for provision in your life. Whatever it may be, look to Jesus today. He is the shepherd. He meets all of our needs, and we can trust him. He has the power to do it, and we can trust him. Let's close in prayer. Father, we thank you so much for this demonstration of your power through Jesus, the shepherd. We thank you that we benefit from the care of the shepherd as we trust in Jesus Christ for salvation. And we look forward to the day when we will see the messianic shepherd Jesus return and shepherd your people Israel. We thank you for your care in our lives. Help us to trust you, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to close with a song that reflects these ideas about our shepherd and our need to trust him. Aaron, come and lead us in that.
Please stand and turn your blue hymnals with me to hymn number 85, Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us, hymn number 85 in the blue hymnals. We'll stand together as we sing.
Blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us, thine we are. Blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us, thine we are.
You are dismissed.